Welcome again, all of you. Hope all of you are in safe and good health. Today in this lecture, I'll analyze Dickinson's famous poem, Because I Could Not Stop for Death. Dickinson and death are the two words so frequently used that it is difficult to read this white-robed nun of New England without being able to understand the real purport of her love for death. Her obsessive concern for death, or you can say the absence of abhinivesh. Abhinivesh means fear of death. So absence of abhinivesh in her thoughts is quite conspicuous in her poems. One of the obvious reasons for this was her early acquaintance with death in life. It is a very sad part of her life. For 15 years up to her 25th year, she lived on Pleasant Street, from where she watched the funeral processions of Amherst. She suffered the death of her parents, relatives, and friends, including J.G. Holland and Reverend Charles Wadsworth. But the most stunning grief came to her in the death of her 8-year-old nephew, Gilbert. A number of poems by Miss Dickinson have the funeral ceremony as their theme. This particular poem, Because I Could Not Stop for Death, is her finest in that category. On the surface, this poem seems like just another version of a procession to the grave. But here it is also a metaphor that can be probed for deeper levels of meaning, spiritual journeys of a very different sort. It is a superlative achievement in which death becomes one of the great characters of literature. Her ambiguous meaning of image seems to have a special appeal to the Indian epistemology. You will relish with this approach. This poem may give poignancy to the last rite of this mortal life, but it is not so. Rather, it is the last rite of the beginning and the end of life altogether. As this poem itself refers to, because I could not stop for death, he kindly stopped for me. The carriage held but just ourselves and immortality. Here the death is presented as a suitor and the soul as a bride. It's very different and bizarre conception you will find here. Death has been very polite to her in coming to stop at her doors to take her out. And in response to his civility, she puts aside her work and leisure to be with him. This idea is most certainly a novel one in English and American poetry. But to an Indian reader, this recalls to mind the devotional song of Kavi. Have you heard his name? Kabir, one of the most distinguished saint poets of India, who always imagined the last journey towards the grave as the going away of the bride to her husband's house. In these lines, he makes assumption of the eternal being as a lover and soul as a beloved. Ram Mure Piyu, Main Ram Ki Bahuriya. It means, God is my lover and I am his soul. Am his bride. Thus, the image of continuous journey includes in it death, life, and immortality simultaneously. This idea of Dickinson indicates that death prolongs throughout our life. It is not a point of time, about a continuous process. All the time which we think living is in fact called dying. How wonderfully this conception resembles one of the rich thoughts of the Bhagavatam. Mrityur janvatam vir dehen sah jayate. It means death is born at the time of body's birth. To Dickinson, death of the gross corpus is not death in the real sense, because it is a physical dome which dies, while the soul always lies, which lies in it, that remains always alive. Dickinson utters these lines, "We slowly drove, he knew no haste, and I had put away my labor and my leisure too for his civility." She means to pour out here that the soul, it is eternal being, gives up the labor and leisure of the body and remains alive in the civilized company of death. A parallel thought can easily be observed in the poetry of Kabir again. Hum na mari hain, mari hai sansara, humko milya jiyavan hara. It means, soul says, I can never die. What is mortal is this world. This is so because I have got the company of the eternal being who perpetuates my life. Thus, she plainly reveals all the stages of life through some images, as is shown here. School symbolizes childhood, children, vitality, rest, transition. Ring symbolizes this word, and fields give you the symbol of maturity, and gazing grain, that is juvenile pleasures, and setting sun, that is a very traditional image. It gives you the image of old age. So this shows the three stages of youth, maturity, and old age in the cycle of day, from morning till evening, and seasonal progress from years of upspring through ripening to decline. Then in further line, she says, or rather he passed us. Now pay attention on this word passed. Here she seems to correct herself, because nobody can go with body to heaven. Finally, the sequence follows the natural route of funeral train, past the schoolhouse in the village, then the outlying fields, and on to the remote burying ground. In the second last stanza, you will find the movement of the poem shows almost to a stop. We paused. Contrast with the successive sides, we passed. In the earlier stage of the journey, you have noted that actually house here is a grave. And this image again reminds us of Thomas Gray's famous line in Elegy, "The path of the glory leads but to the grave." Now the concluding lines clarify the picture that death as a suitor or a lover takes away the bride with him and suddenly deceives her and leaves her alone in the grave. This whole situation produces pathos and sympathy for her because she accepts death's proposal, anticipating that he will make her enter the heaven while she is left spoiled in the grave. So the house of death is not the poet's destination. Yeah, have you noted here? The house of the death is not the poet's destination. Rather, it is eternity, which she longs for. It is another matter. It is significant here that she never reaches it. Such is the preparation for the final stanza in which immortality has replaced the mortality of earth. Since then, it is centuries, and yet feels shorter than the day. I first surmised the horse's heads were toward eternity. Is it clear to you? Actually, such shocks inspire us to go in the depth of the meaning and encourage us to read between the lines. In this process, the essence of the poem is that death is an inevitable issue of the life, but the soul remains unaffected from it because it is immortal, unlike the physique. Thus, it arouses in our mind mingled feelings of heartache and acceptance, pangs of regret, and a reconciliation with the ultimate end, hope and despair, revolt and accusations. So this was all for today. Hope this lecture will provide you a better perception to comprehend this poem. Meet you again in the next lecture. Thank you.